Chi Chi Garjin, and I'm the president of Baxter Street, and...
And I'm Libby, and I'm the director. And we, together, we, outside of Baxter Street, we're New Jeff Collective, so...
So outside of this, of our leadership roles here, we sort of operate as facilitators under the New Jeff Collective umbrella. So when we were hosting this guest-curated show, it made a lot of sense to us to kind of think about the collaborative practice outside of just what it means to put something on the wall, but actually to facilitate a conversation, to have these dialogues, especially over the arc of art history. It's pretty clear that collaborative practices emerge pretty dramatically in socio-political situations that we're currently in, similar to what we're currently in. So when we see these dips in perhaps you know, in the socio-political bipartisan support of these, of the arts, you can see the collaborative practices kind of emerge. And so we felt like this was a great time for us to bring to light three different types of practices. Us as moderators, we act as facilitators through our publishing entity called Secretary Press. And we also create events that are more socially engaged, a socially engaged practice. So then that extends into what we do here at Baxter Street at the Camera Club of New York, where community is the basis of everything that we do. So we're really excited to be hosting two different, you know, this conversation, which you'll see once the lights are out, about the visual collaboration on the wall, but also with Matthew and Bia and the way that they create a collaborative practice outside of their own individual practices.
So we were really thinking about the different ways, like, I think each, you know, we're not going to talk that much about ourselves, mm-hmm. But the, you know, the way New Draft does things is it's very experiential, and you host an event, you experience it, and then it goes away. And separate from that, the way that Studio Duo, which is Matt Papa and Bia Montero, Studio Duo hosts exhibitions. So that's also experiential, it's temporal, and then it goes away. But part of your practice is this sort of collective space where you're making your own work, and then you're working together to put together these exhibitions. And you've also started working on images together, yeah, too, right? Very, yeah, recently?
Not entirely. I mean, there were some earlier ones, but when you guys approached us to, you know, for the sort of market that we were like, oh, that's a perfect opportunity to start making some more things, mm-hmm, together. So.
Okay.
And there are other things that we have.
Yeah, and you guys, they're going to do a little presentation with these collaborative pieces. Right. Mm-hmm. And then Tal Gilboa, mm-hmm, and Liz Kleber also work together in a way that's actually not necessarily temporal at all, because they're making these sculptures and these videos that don't go away, that are objects that can be sold and stick around, and you can experience them today and tomorrow and 10 years from now and 20 years from now. So I think we were thinking it's a very interesting, the three different ways in which the collaborations are working, and we'll have more questions for you guys later. So
no trick ones, right?
No.
So Studio Duo is going to speak first, and then Tal and Liz, and then we'll have questions. So.
Do you want the lights out for presentation?
Yeah. Yeah, I think that would be helpful.
Oh, yeah. There's a lot of AV happening here.
Feel free to use these transitions to get some wine or water if you haven't.
Good point.
So I just want to say welcome to everyone and thank you for coming. catch us that I'm Matthew Papa, and this is Bea Montero. We're studio mates and collaborators in studio duo. We just wanted to thank Livy and Michi for inviting us to participate, and also Kyle and Liz for joining us for the conversation. I thought we would start by introducing ourselves briefly and explain the genesis of Studio Duo, and then we'll get into some of the projects that Bea and I have worked on, including The Artist Body, which was the show we curated together this past spring. Bea and I met in 2014 when we started the MFA program at ICP Bard here in New York. There are a couple of characteristics about the program that I think ultimately opened us up to the possibilities of collaboration. And the first, which I think is a really important one, was the focus on experimentation, which I think is unique to the program. And we were really challenged and encouraged throughout the full 2 years to explore different methods and ways of working. The other was something that I appreciate more now that I'm out of the program and back in the real world. The chair of our program, Nayland Blake, would always say that if there was a conversation you want to have in the art world, don't sit around and wait for somebody to invite you to it, make the conversation yourself. So during the program, there were a number of public events that we were required to organize, often as a group. And they provided each of us with the experience and skills to put together a show or create an event, like a lecture or a panel discussion. And they kind of like worked us up in sort of like baby steps, like first with like open studios, and then eventually with like a full-scale public symposium where we invited academics and we had to conceptualize the whole event. So both of those experiences, becoming open to new ways of working and feeling empowered and capable to have a voice in the art world, ultimately informed the trajectory of both my and Bea's work and our work as Studio Duo.
So Matt and I had spoken about sharing a studio towards the end of the program, and but it actually happened faster than we expected. We just saw one studio space, and which we are still there now. And so within a month, after a month of graduating, we found the space, we loved it, and we decided to seize the opportunity. But we were not actually, at that point, we were not thinking about collaborating. It was more towards our individual practices. So the studio became a place where we carried forward the notion of experimentation as well as just playing around. On my work, this is actually, I exhibited this piece here at our final show at the ICP. I print on alternative materials, and that's something that I've been exploring since grad school. First I printed on wood, which is this piece here, and then the past spring I had a show in Tokyo for which I had some images printed on cement. And in the studio, I tried painting, I tried screen printing, collage, which all of them become part of my daily practice. Even though they're not always successful, I'm always trying different materials. In Linhas Modernas, Modern Line series, which includes the printing on cement, I'm questioning the utopian aspects of the Brazilian modernist architecture and their relationship with the landscape. For this work, which is also part of the same series, I'm doing collage, digital and 3D collage. And then I realized that the process of layering, it keeps coming more and more strong into my work. The layering process found in the work usually starts by relating to different social layers of the community. From there, I manipulate the images with variety of tools, from digital to specific materials in the image itself. I feel that most of the time, I'm trying to understand the subject by altering it. This is the last image from the series, Reimagindo Terra Firme, or Reimagining Dry Land, which is it's still in the process and was done at an artist residency this past July called Lab Verde in the Brazilian Amazon. And it's a performative work where I put my body in the forest and I remeasure it using a personal dimension and questioning the references of measuring that the European colonizers defined 200 years ago. And then I make the image and then I draw on top of it. I'm just showing like a few little images of my work just so you get to know what informs our collective practice on the end. And then it wasn't until recently that we actually found, we realized that we were both doing similar things in different ways. So we have this huge metal board behind our desk in the studio, and we keep whatever we're working on, we keep there. And then sometimes, even though the work is very different, we see the similarities. And I think that's also like something that it became super strong and for us recently, especially after doing our curatorial process together.
And so similar to Bia, when I started exploring new projects after finishing the MFA, I sort of felt unsatisfied with sort of straight or really direct images. And my first impulse was to explore collage, but within the camera. Before the MFA, I'd done a lot of self-portraiture, but it became less of a focus when I was working primarily with other people during the program. And so I wanted to return to it when I finished and see where those different experiences could help me push it past a place. And I think some of the reason that I kind of abandoned it for a little bit was that I sort of felt stuck. And so this first image that I'm showing you, it's all composed in front of the camera. And I was trying to complicate the photographic plane and the reading of the image. And I think we're so accustomed to digital manipulation that we always assume when we see something that feels layered that it's been manipulated with the computer, and this was all done in three-dimensional space. So this next piece, my starting point was, and I'm showing you these kind of chronologically, and similarly, like with Bia, we're kind of doing like a very minimal edit of stuff. And so this one, the starting point was this image that I had found of myself from when I first moved to New York, which was the early 90s, and I was in my 20s. And I'm from the Midwest originally. I came out in the 80s, and you know, the representations of gay male desire were still very hidden at that time. And I think, you know, now, a couple decades later, it's such a different experience with internet and Tumblr. And also acceptance that I started to wonder, like, what kind of power do these images still hold? Because you know, there used to be these places where you'd have to go, you'd have to know where to go, and they would be in brown bags. And so I was curious if they still held any power. And I think my impulse to layer and bring the images together is sort of this reflection about how, now that I'm old enough to have a number of experiences, is how experience is kind of like these things that like accrue onto your body and that often the sum is greater than the parts. And then this last, I'm just going to show you a few images. These are really recent and they're very much in process. They're really a reflection of my interest in the studio as a place of fantasy, and I'm still playing around with perceptions of the body and space and how images affect the way we understand ourselves and form our identity. I'm trying to tap into a sense of play that allows me to see the materials that I have at hand in the studio, which is really different than the experience that I've had before.
And so as we became aware of some of these overlaps in the work, we thought it would be interesting to do something together after a year and a half sharing the studio. So we had this studio and we were looking for ways to push ourselves into a new territory. And initially we thought about doing a publication that would focus on the body, which is something that both of us work, but in different, totally different ways and approaches. And then we discussed about the publication and we thought the best idea would be to have an open call, so then we could attract a wider range of artists especially because we're just coming out of ICP, so ICP community was, still is, but it was a very strong community for us, but we wanted to get more open to that. So we created the Artist Body show, and it was co-curated with Justin Kerlin. The show was up for 10 days in May. It included photography and video from 17 artists from all over the world. And me as an international artist, I thought it was crucial to the show to have international artists on that show as well. So it was a super successful experience, and we learned so many aspects, good and bad, about putting up a show together. We still intend to do the publication. With the, some of the show that were in the work, but also we wanted to expand with writing and also give more detail to specific few artists, not only just one or two images of each one.
Yeah, the space was really small, so we had to like really edit everybody down.
And these are some images of the installation shots of the show. So we have another project in the works. It's a second group show called Considering the Landscape, which also uses the body as the main concept, as the starting point, the departure point, looks like. And we were gonna do that this fall now, but we had issues with the space, and now we're still figuring out when we can make it happen, and hopefully soon. But we are planning to get these two shows together, and then by towards that, we're gonna end up doing the first edition of the publication. And it was very important to us also the concept of, because we have different approaches to the body, we wanted to open up, I mean, the body has been something studied in art history since its beginning, so we wanted to open up also the conversation towards different ways of approaching it.
So we were invited to participate in the conversation after Amici came to see the Artist Body, and instead of just talking about the curatorial practice, we sort of took it as an opportunity to create some new work together. And we're still experimenting, but it's been really exciting to collaborate in other ways. And the process of conceptualizing work and making decisions together and sharing ideas has been a great experience for both of us. I think, you know, there's always so much ego in art making, and that, you know, when one of the ingredients that we sort of said we would only use things that are already in the studio, and we both have like a ton of work prints, and so it's really interesting when somebody else handles your work and sort of sees sort of different things in it and combines them in different ways. And so that's sort of been a really interesting process to sort of be able to kind of view what you do from a different angle and kind of let go and not be so attached to something. So the first one that we made was like, it was kind of like child's play and was really easy. I think we weren't really second guessing a lot of what we did. And, you know, we started off with a reference from a Andy Warhol silkscreen of Mick Jagger, and just sort of played with that and then used those parameters. We recently made a second one, and it was, you know, something we had to kind of like walk away from and be like, this one's totally fucked up. Like, we have to bring like fresh eyes to it. And so I think that's something from my experience that feels easier to do in collaboration than when you're on your own. Like, I feel like it's harder to let go of something and not beat yourself up over not being able to find what the solution is, and that sometimes having somebody from like a different place, from a different perspective, can bring that to it. So these are just some process shots. And the studio's been like a really great place for us to kind of play together and not really have any expectations of sort of what comes out of it. we don't really know where it will lead to, but we've been dedicating like every Friday is like a day that we do this together. That's sort of a new part of our practice. And we just kind of really let ourselves have fun with it, right? sometimes alcohol's involved at the end of the day. Yeah, surprising. So we each usually bring like different sort of references or texts or something that's like a starting point. And so I think what we found is that, you know, it's not just sort of what we make together, but this way that it allows us to go back to what we do as individuals that kind of gives us a sense of openness to the other things that we do. So thank you. Thanks for coming. And I'll turn it over to you guys now.
And thank you for having us in this space. We're really excited to have an opportunity to show work and our work. It's very much like site specific in that some of it's made in the space, and so having the opportunity to have a space for a certain period of time is really valuable to what we do.
Definitely, and actually talking about the work where it's shown is great, because I think images of this kind of work can only do so much, and so it's really cool to have you guys see everything while we talk about it.
Yeah.
It's
really
good. Okay.
So we also met in grad school,
and can you guys hear in the back? Sorry. Yes. Is the sound okay? We can turn it off. It's just
lower.
Yeah.
Sorry. I'm going to turn it off in a little bit.
So we went to Pratt, and that's where we met. And we started collaborating after the first semester of moving to Rick, so it's almost 3 years now that we've been working together. And I mean, we kind of became friends, we liked each other's work, we hung out and talked about art, and then it was suggested to us, like, not very seriously, by a professor that we both really admired, and so we decided to give it, to just try it out over winter break, and it worked, and so we just kept going and kind of merged into this other thing. And we, at this point, this is our practice. I mean, we don't really distinguish like our personal practice and the collaboration. And
yeah, I think maybe be interesting to know that we both kind of have a background in painting and drawing and collage making and tallis making, these small kind of beautiful intimate little collages, and I was like experimenting with video, with using found footage, and so the first kind of piece we made was like a stop motion collage made into video, and so I think that that's still very much in our practice, and drawing and painting and collage making, even though the work is usually manifests itself in as video and sculpture and video sculpture, we like to describe it that way, or as collage, video collage.
Yeah, I think collage is at the core of a lot of what we're doing, thinking about how you take ideas or images or pieces from different spheres and put them together. Like, we come from different places. I'm from Jerusalem, Israel. Liz is from Virginia. We have like different backgrounds, different stories, different everything, kind of, or maybe not, I don't know. But we come together and we make this work, and so these points of connection between us and between the videos and the materials are where, this is where we find interest, like this is where we think.
Yeah, we think about collage making as like a strategy or like an impulse, like to take two things and put them together and find that like tenuous point where they meet and maybe where they don't meet. And so we like when things are, or when a piece is...
Oh, 10 bucks!
maybe not fully like fused, but there's like still some some instances where the two are still their own thing, and then when they create this moment where they create a third thing that maybe is less defined or less definitive.
So we usually shoot videos on our iPhones, so that means like walking around in the world and seeing something of interest and kind of like picking it up or like gleaning it from our experiences and then bringing it into the studio and talking about it and like having the other one see something in it that we didn't see. But the other part of the practice is the collage making in the studio. So like this piece is originally an image of flamingos that we cut and kind of moved back and forth. So iPhone videos mixed with like cut pieces of collages in the studio are the working material, and then you put them in the video editing program and project them in space, and that's kind of when the fun part starts, because we try different approaches. We kind of have all these materials in our studio, and then we try to find where the video needs to be, like what would be the material that would hold the video, what would be the material that would expand the video into something that we think is more interesting. And
I think it's funny, we don't really talk about this much, but so much of the creative process happens when we meet in the studio and we like share about our lives and about the extraneous parts of our lives that don't really like explicitly show up in the work, but that is like what the work's about in the end. You know, it's like personal is there, but maybe it's not totally explicitly the subject matter. But I think more and more, maybe this show in particular seems really personal or like very felt to us, and so I think that's something that we're trying to articulate, how the personal and the individual parts of our practice meet, and are they like both of us? Are they this other person or this other entity that's like that exists in the work? And for that, for us, that's interesting. Letting it be a collaborative practice. That's we're two artists and we're working together, but we don't really pick apart the parts of the work that are our individuals or like this other third thing.
Yeah, and so in terms of studio practice, I guess like half the time is spent, not half the time, but like we meet in the studio and we talk about like our lives, our day, our relationships, our families, or everything kind of comes in. And so for this show, we were thinking that that kind of becomes the subject matter, like these relationships that we have, our relationship as a collaborative as collaborative artists, but also the other relationships we have in our lives, our relationship with our family that's far away, or with our partners, or with Liz's baby, or like, so we think that a lot of this work deals with the idea of like coming together and forming a relationship, or trying to hold this relationship that is kind of hard to describe or to grab or to like physically have sometimes.
Yeah, we talked a lot about choreography. We talk a lot about choreography in our work. We look at dance a lot. We think about dance a lot. And dance comes into this piece in the front. But the choreography of relationships and the choreography of our relationship and our process, and that sort of like moving together, moving apart, like fluidity of movement that sometimes exists in the videos like very obviously, and sometimes it's just about the way we work. They really want to talk to you. Yeah.
Yeah, so what else should we say? I think a lot of the work happens for us in the space. So we were very fortunate to have a whole week to install in here. And it's great because we kind of come in with the projectors and we have some idea of what we want, but a lot of this work it's funny that you talk about temporal or something that stays, because we feel like these works change whenever, like when the next time we show this work, it's going to look different, because it's going to be a different space, it's going to be a
right.
different corner, the ceiling, the so they stay, obviously, they have a presence in time, but they're also very specific to the space. And a lot of what ends up happening is we kind of experiment and we try to see what would happen with the plastic pieces reflecting on this wall and what would be the relationship to the other work. And so it becomes hopefully this experiential and like thing that you have to like stay in the space for like a duration and take it all in with you.
Yeah. I think maybe improvisation works its way into that part of it as well. Like in the studio where we like took an improvisation class together, and like we like to think about like the yes and of improvisation, and when one offers something, we make it a rule that we always say yes and sort of like build on each other, and then when something hits a wall, like we just maybe just let it go, but we can't say no. The only time we've said no, but it never works. So, but that's like a not a rule, but like definitely a way that we think about the process in the studio and then in the space and installing, making the work.
Yeah, it's like a good method for working together. We found once you like name it or take the name yes and sometimes when we find ourselves struggling, one of us would say like, oh my god, I just said no but, that's why we're like stuck, and so we know what to call it and how to like fix it and move on.
Right.
So it's like a tool. Improvisation is like a method or a tool that we use to like keep things going in the studio and keep things like flowing and moving on.
Yeah,
that's okay.
Yeah. Great. I guess we could tell you what the pieces, that there's this two channel piece in the front is called This Shape Has No Place. And then there's video sculpture that's standing over here on the your right, and that's called Pears. And then this is this projection up here of the plastic is pink. And then this piece is Diaphragm, Let Me Hold Your Breath.
Yeah, Let Me Hold Your Breath is the title of the show. And
just hard to see when everybody's in here. Like, what's
And we thought it would, it's kind of it's suggesting of a relationship of someone asking someone else for something, or us asking the audience for something and asking for time and allowing like this moment that can't actually happen or can happen, holding someone's breath, I don't know, but it suggests an intimacy and it suggests a relationship that we think is important for experiencing the show.
So in our in preparing for this part of the conversation, Libby and I wrote down a few questions just to think about how we would talk to the.
Should we turn the lights on? Do you think?
Yeah.
Also, maybe let's just turn the lights on. So.
Yeah.
Sorry. It's terrible light, but it's their fault because they made us take all of the warm light out.
Yeah.
The look of the ceiling.
We're sorry about that.
Yeah.
So we collaboratively, the way that we work when we're preparing for something, and I think it's kind of funny because it was, they were touching on a lot of these different things, where we'll start a Google Doc. So one of the ones that we were thinking about was, you know, the notions of authorship when you're talking about, or ownership, however you want to think about it. And it's interesting when, Liz and Tal, when you were speaking about it, it's almost as if your collaborative practice has become an avatar of the two of you. Whereas it's very, and in the case of Studio Duo, it's very clear that there's these two practices that are coming together to facilitate. So it's nice to see that difference between the two of them. So I thought maybe you could elaborate on where you feel like it can go from there. I mean, it almost seems like the two the studio duo is coming closer together to work more collaboratively to create these pieces, but you've already gone there. Do you ever see yourselves having an individual practice outside of this? And
no. I think when we were very nervous at first, like saying that we were a collaborative team, because there's that, you know, fear of like losing some sort of personal, I don't know, experience of art making. Or maybe I was more nervous than you were. I think that that's very fair. I was like, yes, never again, we're all in this together, let's make work. And I think I was like, oh no, like I was making work that, you know, people wanted to make very individual and very personal, and so I thought that was important to making art. And then I think the longer that we've worked together, the more I've like suspended that expectation. And then I think we've just said that as long as it is still energizing and motivating and exciting, and we're still making things that we both are intrigued by and excited about, then we just will work together. So we kind of aren't looking so far down the line and just sort of taking it one day at a time.
I agree. I was excited about the idea of working in collaboration. Like ideologically, politically, I believe like that it's super powerful, and I think that we're like, to me, it's kind of where I feel like I'm myself more in this collaboration. I feel like I was able to express more of what I wanted to, and I didn't for some reason. I think it gives me power and it gives us power. I agree. As long as it's energizing, and as long as we feel like we can make, we keep wanting to make work together, I think we'll keep going.
I think for us, I think we're in that phase of being super excited for sharing, because we do share a lot in the studio. He's the first person that critiques my work, and the first person that critiques his work on a daily basis. So we have this interaction towards the individual practice. So there is this line that we have in between, you know, you can't cross the line. You set the lines naturally, either when doing a critique. But once we started working together, then it's something else, because I don't have the same, when he gives me his prints and to do whatever I want to do with it, just rip it off or paint on top or burn it, whatever, it's something that it's not as prestigious as the print that I see on his process, creative process, as an individual artist. So it's
yeah, and I think that for that, it feels very much like it's kind of a beginning in a way, like we're sort of, it's you know, it started with this curatorial project together, and I think that we both have very strong personalities, and I think that what's kind of amazing is how well we work together, even though we have these very strong personalities. And so that show was really, I think it really kind of opened us up to like, oh, there's probably a lot of other things that we can do together. And there is this way that it's freeing to be able to like step away from your own work and realize that you have like these other resources that are like right next to you like all week long. And you know, we have this, but I was thinking you're talking about, we have this line, like, you know, we have on the board mostly like it's kind of like split in half, and my partner was there one day and was like, oh, it's really interesting like how much there's this conversation happening between images that you don't really, I don't think you guys like really see that's there. So I feel like there's a lot more places that we could go with it, and I think, you know, really the limiting factor is really time. You know, it's like, how much can you, you know, you guys are working in this way where your work is all together, and so I think we're still in this place where we are doing our own separate work, and then we do things together, and it's really like, some of it's like logistics, figuring out like how you take it to the next place and find the space for all the things we do.
Yeah, I was just thinking, like, you know, you're both
talking about sort of the genesis of your collaborations, and 3 years is both a long time, but it's also not that much time. And so I was thinking about how you both sort of set up these rules for each other, and part of this question of like authorship is, do you define the roles that you have? Like, are there definitions of the things that you guys do? Like, maybe you're better. I remember you saying that like Tal's really good at like doing the menu details of like putting things together, even such small things as that. Like, you've got the rule of like only using things in the studio, or the rule of like yes and. And did you sort of set out other rules for yourselves as you were like starting to work together?
I mean, I think there's definitely like really big differences that it's also, it's really useful for me with Bia, because I can be a little obsessive and over precise and like have a hard time kind of like letting certain things go. And I think, you know, you can sense that, and there's a way where you're like, just like, fuck it. Like, you know, we can always make another print or whatever, you know?
Yeah.
And so I think that's like a very, really big difference that I can see in terms of like the way.
I think spending so much time together, it's like, it's any relationship, it's either so intimate with the person, and like you're saying, you bring so much of your personal life. I think it takes like, I don't know, 1 hour before we start working.
Yeah,
even our individual practices just to listen to what the other one has to say. But then we also find places where that dialogue that I think builds up the intimacy and the work, the way we work together. Even how close we sit together and everything, but then it's a daily practice. And then when it comes to authorship and hierarchy, then I think it's all about the same. Because I think one thing balances the other at the end. And the other voice is just one. It's just one voice for the collective. So I think that's the
giving up the ego,
yeah.
As you said.
Okay.
Giving up the ego,
yeah.
As you said. Yeah.
But also, like asserting yourself as a team. I mean, I think we found that it was a bit of a struggle in the beginning, because this question of who does what or what the rules are was really hard for us in the beginning. We had, you talked about the great experience in grad school of people like encouraging collaboration.
Right.
We had not so much the same experience. Like, it was a bit of a struggle to kind of convince people of the legitimacy of this endeavor. Like, we had this one administrator ask us, he said, you gotta understand, we have to know who's the horse and who's the cart. And we're like, what do you mean? Like, why do you assume that one is doing more than the other? Why do you assume that one is
mooching up the other?
Yeah. And it was a struggle for some people to understand this as like something that is collaborative and doesn't have a hierarchy and doesn't have like one person does the video and the other one does the sculpture.
Yeah.
Or some, or so it took us a while when we started in school to like find a way to explain to people that this is what we are. We are a collaborative practice, and I mean, over time we learned to appreciate like what we each bring into the collaboration.
Mm-hmm.
Obviously we have like certain qualities that we take advantage of, so we don't, we're not like equal, but we are kind of equal in the process.
Well, and don't you think too that like time and circumstances can change like the role that you're able to play, like depending on whatever is happening in a particular day or whatever, there's like a way that, you know, like just the process of, you know, 24 hours passing allows maybe one person to like step in a different way that they wouldn't have before.
Yeah.
I don't know if you know, maybe you do that by yourself, but I think it's different in relationship, because there's a way that, like, I think that some of the basis of collaboration is like a sense of empathy for the other person, and empathy about what you're trying to do and achieve, and so I think that sort of allows you to sort of like play different roles with one another.
And trusting each other to take
that was something I was going to ask, that the trust factor. When was the first time that you realized, and this might be a tricky question, but that you really trusted each other? Like, is there a moment in your collaborative practice where you were like, you sort of went for it and trusted the other person?
I would say, I've never thought about this at all. And I would have said day one, just like, you know, we made a collage out of things that were in my studio and like, just sort of messed everything up. But I think maybe personally, I'm really thinking about it, we made this one work in grad school that was like maybe kind of well received, but like very bizarre, like people couldn't really describe it. But it came out of sharing this like really kind of tragic experience in my family, where this like sacred home that we all like loved and I grew up in and was like for terrible circumstances was sold and like I was having this really emotional experience with this place and like all these memories and identity. And Kyle was like, this work is about the, you know, this beach house. and then it came and I was like, oh wow, Kyle's like entering into this thing that's very personal and she hasn't experienced it at all. And then but then allowing that to enter into this bit, the collaborative space, and like letting something else be generated from that experience was like I think a really big moment for us to like go there and to broach that personal space, and then to say like that's like fair game. And I don't know if you thought about that, but for me that was like really cool that you were like, yes, this work is about this thing that you've never experienced, but you like experienced through the collaboration.
Yeah, which kind of goes to your idea of empathy as well, sort of allowing the trust to cross over to that empathy.
For sure.
And how can we, as two people, deal with one person's psychological like thoughts? Like how, I think today when we think of like identity politics or art that's about your subject, it can be kind of limiting in my view, or confining in a way. And I think that the way we work, we're kind of like, this work to me is about lesbian relationships because that's my life, but we made it together, so it's about that, but it's also about something else. It can expand, and once you try to take it on.
Yeah, it's like about lesbian relationships and like motherhood.
Well, that's what's funny, because when you were talking to it, I was like, oh, that's like her 4-month-old son.
Yeah.
You know.
But yeah, but it's both, I think, right. And other things as well.
Yeah.
When Michi and I are working, we both are thinking of things and we're bringing our own experiences to it. And then there's often a gap in communication where we're like, oh, we need to get back on the same plane. You know, we're like, are going together, and then we're like this, and then we're like this, and you know.
But I think that's what informs the work at the end. I remember when we were, so we had to hang up the show, the artist's body, and then our co-curator, Justine, she had an issue, a personal issue, and she couldn't come. So we had planned more or less the images, but we hadn't received all the pieces. And we had to hang up the show because we only had 2 days left. And so we had to, in the end, we had to make the decisions between me and him. We did FaceTime, but it's different when you're in the space. So I remember that I made my whole selection and the show was done. And then Matt was like, no, Bio, I don't think you should do this. So he moved everything again. And then I told him, listen, okay, I have my version, you have your version, then let's have Studio Duo version. And that was super successful, and it was great to go through the process of giving up what I thought, because I was biased towards my work, and he was, as you can, and then I felt that I was informing him, he was informing it, and we ended up doing something which was a collective choice.
Well, and to add to that, I had, when we were selecting a lot of the images in the beginning, we were kind of imagining them in the space, how they would work together. And I was doing that a lot with Justine, and I was getting like, I had kind of gotten kind of attached to sort of how we thought they would be. And I think that's where I think you're sort of good at like letting that sort of stuff go, where I'm like, it's a plan, we're gonna stick with the plan. And you know, and I came to the studio and you had like moved all of them around. And I was like, that one.
And it was interesting because we were dealing with other people's work, which is another level of responsibility. So it was not just me and him, and our personal thoughts were artistic.
And this was something that I was going to say when you talked about trust, is that, you know, I mentioned that I think we both have really strong personalities, but I think that we're both really open to seeing, like, what's like, we're not so fixed that we're like not able to see. So if you get stuck or whatever, if you try something and it works, the person isn't so attached to some position that they, you know. And I think that speaks to sort of trust, like, okay, this person has shown me something before that I haven't seen, so it'll probably happen again.
I mean, I think too, like, you know, working so closely with someone, they see, you have to trust them because they see all of your horrible, terrible sides too. You know, they see like the great things, but they also see a lot of the bad things too, you know, and like when you get into stressful situations and you're trying to create something, then like you can get really, you know, sometimes you I'm saying you, but I mean me, because like speaking from experience, like, you know, I can get like, you can get stressed out and frustrated and et cetera, et cetera. So it's a real lesson in how to just in personal relationships too, but it's so intimate, this act of creating together.
Mm-hmm. And I find that idea of being that intimate with someone and then having those moments, it's like when I have a moment, Libby picks me up, or when she has a moment, I pick her up. So it's kind of going back to that ebb and flow towards productivity, you know. Mm-hmm.